think we're good to start. I want to introduce the talk and thank you for coming. Thank you to the panelists and thank you to Calm Collective for inviting me to moderate. We are, what did Melissa say? Oh, sorry. I'm going to start by introducing myself. I'm Sabine Rothman. I'm editor, creative consultant, and founder at Interiors Academy. And I want to thank Calm Collective for inviting me to moderate this fabulous panel designed by Melissa Mattag to approach a subject that's near and dear to all of us, the importance of craft, creativity, and small business. So to paraphrase their intent, the Calm Collective's intent, we're going to talk about how makers really weave a net that supports regional and local communities, regional and local economies, how we can support artisans and the role they play in shaping the future. So it's not a big topic, right? Just, you know, but it is complex and it's interesting. And I think we're all really, you know, we have wonderful people here today. So I want to introduce our four amazing panelists. I know not everyone has the same format as I do, but I'm going to start with Brad because he's in my top left. Brad's a New York-based interior designer who sort of combines a warm sense of soul with a spare modern aesthetic. And in 2014, Brad created Field and Supply, which is an event in the Hudson Valley that's a modern interpretation of a traditional arts and crafts fair. And it has kind of, it's turned into a huge crush, and we have I have a big crush on it. I'm a big fan, and it's has been held twice a year in order to connect a global community with artisans who practice traditional craftsmanship in new ways. And he also has a wonderful showroom in the New York Design Center. And Jomo Tariku, am I pronouncing that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Asked before, is an Ethiopian American industrial designer based in Springfield, Virginia, who is defining a new design language for modern African themed furniture, synthesizing his experience and research into the continent's diverse cultural heritage, creativity, and natural environment. Jomo developed his skills with a local furniture builder in Ethiopia during summer breaks and studied industrial design at the University of Kansas. And his work has been shown in Dubai, at Venice Design, at Africa by Design in Ghana, at ICFF, at Solana, and at Solene in Milan. Patrick, now I'm going this way. Patrick McBride is at the helm of his family's textile printing house, Tillett Textiles, in Sheffield, Massachusetts, Western Massachusetts. The company was started by his great-grandparents in the 1940s and represents four generations of designers, artists, creators, and innovators in textile design. And I think you still have at least two generations working in the business,
yeah,
but you'll tell us.
Yeah.
So Tillett employs traditional techniques of hand printing and offers new designs and the ability to recolor patterns from the archives. And it's an amazing archive that we will hear more about. Catherine Bailey is the co-owner and creative director of San Francisco based and Sausalito based Heath Ceramics. And you and your husband, Robin, took over this legendary California pottery in 2003. Kathy leads the company's visionary design, driving Heath forward while preserving its legacy in craft and manufacturing. And Heath, which you'll tell us more about, was founded in 1948. So it really does also have a long and wonderful history. So I think we should just get right to it and start by defining our terms, really. We use the terms craftsman, artisan, and maker. I want to know if you feel they're synonymous and also how they've changed over time. I just got a sounds nice and clear. Yay. Who would like to start? What about Patrick?
Yes. I'm not so sure if they're equally changeable in the spectrum of it. I think that there are people who could certainly identify as being a maker, and to make something, there might be several components which involve perhaps a craftsman. And so I think someone can be a furniture maker, but not necessarily a tool craftsman or, you know, some sort of beautiful skill that is a component of that. So.
Jamo, how do you define yourself as a craftsman, an artisan, a maker? Is there a...
Definitely not a craftsman, because I'm working with one to build to build one of my chairs, and I see what kind of years and years of experience is interpreted into that chair. So would I be able to make that? No. Do I do shop stuff? Yes, I do. I do my own prototypes. I do have a small shop in here. So I used to be part of a makerspace once, and I remember I joined to get access to the machines. Mm-hmm. But what I found out was there was a whole bunch of us, architects, industrial designers, graphic designers, that were using this makerspace. And initially, maybe this is about 7 years ago, it sounded like us, you know, guys who went to college to study design, finding a place to work and create things that we wanted to release in the market. But as time progressed, I did see the DIY type of crowd that it comes up with ideas to bring it into the market. So it was not necessarily only people who studied professional design programs, but people who also came up with good ideas, but would come and take a class, try to catch up with people like us who had shop classes in college and build their own things. Some collaborated, some did their own thing. So I see the maker maybe in one, if you put one big timeline, what at the end is an artisan or a craftsman who has years and years of experience that he's poured in to be called such a person, like my furniture maker, versus the one who has the 5 years under their belt. Yes, they will produce, let's say, a cutting board or a Turner bowl, but you can distinguish a bowl made by, you know, someone who just started versus someone, you know, who's had 10, 20 years of experience because of material selection, how it's finished, how, you know, there is a lot of soul into that. And that's where, for me, what the difference between a maker and an artisan or a craftsman is.
And it's interesting too, I think, because there's sort of, it's like with artists, there's this sort of myth of the like singular maker, right? It's alone in your studio kind of creating, but that's not really, once you get to scale, a little bit of scale, that's not necessarily how your businesses work. And I wonder, Kathy, maybe that kind of is something you can speak to in terms of definitions. And I think you probably have artisans and not artisans working with you, craftspeople and...
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that, you know, the word maker is kind of interesting. I think it's changed as in reflect to scale and industrialization. And I don't think you have to be a craftsman or an artisan to be a maker. There, you know, you can just make things that they don't have to have craft and they don't have to have, you know, an artistic nature even. But what we do, we like to tie those things together. But there is a scale question, and the scale question is like constantly evolving. And, you know, it starts in like arts and crafts movement, right, where they're kind of... you know, at that point, like how they were determining manufacturing, kind of taking away craft, was radically different than how we define that today, and the use of hands in manufacturing and how that's all changed. So, but to me, like maker today does represent, you know, less automated, more handmade kind of making.
Mm-hmm. And Brad, you run a fair for makers, let's say. What are the kind of criteria that you do? Oh, sorry, I had a glitch and I thought you were stopped.
No, I'm good. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. I was going to ask Brad, but as someone who runs a fair for, I guess it's for makers, really. How do you define the terms? And also, sort of, what are your criteria? Because it's a vetted show, right? It's a show that not everybody can.
I actually think maker is kind of a new buzzword.
Yeah.
You hear it a lot in the craft world. I don't think there's that, you know, people call me an interior designer, they call me an interior decorator. I'm probably the last person to get hung up on labels. I don't think of it too much. Mm-hmm. I do think that, as Kathy was saying, there are people that do craft, but they may not, and they may have a skill set, but not necessarily the artistry that we sort of look for with who we work with. So for us, it's about, you know, someone that does beautiful craft work, but also has a certain eye that creates an artistic piece and a sort of elevated component that makes it feel like it could work in a number of contexts. That's sort of what we look for in the showroom. For the arts and crafts for itself, you know, it's a much broader category base of, you know, fashion, furniture, jewelry, pet products, and, you know, so it's kind of hard to define for me or distinguish between the, you know, terms maker, artisan, and craftsperson. I just don't think of it that much.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I what I also like about it is that it's really about identity as well.
Mm-hmm.
How they want to identify themselves. We clearly work with decorators, interior designers, interior decorators, product, you know, furniture maker. I mean, we work with all of those things, and people, you know, people have this varied identity, and I'm great, go for it.
And each of you has that too. And I think it also, what one of the things Brad was talking about was the eye, and as with art, it's the intention, you know, like, what's behind what you're doing. So I wanted to talk about why it's important to kind of celebrate and share and nurture craftsmanship and tradition. And I thought maybe it was a good opportunity for each of you to tell a little bit more about what you do specifically and the kind of, you know, what's important to you in this work. Jomo.
The high level of craftsmanship is where my work gets redefined. Yes, it moves from a simple idea to a sketch to a 3D model, then maybe a basic prototype. But then that where I go looking after that is you know, someone who understands my language, who can take that and reinterpret it and refine it, like Brad said earlier. It's that. You know, I'm looking for someone who has that eye, who can speak the same language as me. So again, I'm not trying to say maker is less or not. It's just that for me, as a furniture designer who's looking for a refined level of craftsmanship, my expectation is a little bit higher. It's, you know, it is also reflected in the products I'm trying to introduce to the market. Mm-hmm. Is because I'm hiring someone who can do, you know, for example, the Niala chair, the armrests have to be hand carved. Have we tried to do that using CNC machines? We have. I've contacted multiple companies trying to do something like that. And, but when you see the person building it, working on that and how much effort that goes into, there is more appreciation into the things you do. Should we nurture it? Yes. I think one of the things that I've seen and what I've struggled with as a furniture designer to get things done in Virginia is, even though ever since I moved here, I kept on hearing Virginia was just as big as North Carolina when it comes to hand making of furniture. Mm-hmm. It took a lot of effort to find even, you know, the person who's working on my chairs right now.
Mm-hmm.
So that tradition has not been passed on, or it has died, because the small shops that supported the large shops disappeared when the larger ones just, you know, unplugged their plants and went outside. And there was no you know, fallback for them. So some of them just left the industry, some of them went into small shops, and those small shops are just harder to find because there's no central database. The states that are invested in this, especially North Carolina, maybe even Virginia and others, need to nurture and keep this tradition. If one family doesn't pass it on to the other, you know, it becomes difficult. Now, the good side, on the flip side, is the maker movement is kind of rebooting this whole thing. That the whole interest of, you know, maker shops and everything, and craftspeople, people who are at the high end of their work, coming and teaching others, I think has been one of the best things that I've seen in the last few years.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting because it's true. I mean, your work is so refined, so distilled, and so it really, it is much harder to make something simple, isn't it? And yes. Pure than, and you do need a level of expertise combined with that level of design to make the objects work.
Yes, and you expect, it's a dialogue, truly. I mean, if you've ever seen a craftsman work on your design, on your vision, and when you see eye to eye on things, and it is like a relationship when one finishes the sentence of the other one. But this is an artistic product or an idea that, you know, that was in my head being reinterpreted by a craftsman. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Kathy, you have a whole studio of people sort of working together. I think this idea of collaboration is so important too. And I'm a little bit obsessed with your studio director also.
Do you want me to explain a little bit how that came about?
Yeah, and how you all sort of work together and
yeah, it's interesting.
The tradition there also.
Yeah, it's relevant to this conversation, I think, because what we found is going from, Heath started as a manufacturer. Not Edith Heath was a potter, but also didn't from the beginning wanted to produce her work in a factory environment and repeat her work, right? Not do individual pieces. So it set off on that. But when we came to it, there was, you know, it was not thriving anymore, but there was about 20 people in the factory. I mean, it was called a plant then, it wasn't called a studio, and they were making the Heathware, same as they'd been making it more or less, you know, for the previous 50-ish years. And so, you know, we wanted to make the business viable. It needed to be bigger than that to work. And we grew the factory in the amount that we were able to produce. But to the point, you know, after about, gosh, it was probably like 10 or 11 years in, it started being like that the efficiency that was being pushed from the factory and some like the balance of the creating and the production felt so radically different than it did when there was 20 people, just totally radically different. And you couldn't go down in the factory anymore and just work with the people working down there to do something new. It was too, you know, to make the business work, it had to be too structured the point of what you were doing just really changed, right? So that experimentation, that understanding of pushing the material and exploring the craft, you know, that was no longer, and it was starting to become like a normal design process where that was done in a room where there was like, maybe you're drawing it and having a computer or whatever that was. So whereas it used to be kind of like squeeze into the factory floor. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to have a studio that could go back to that like really essential way of working and didn't have the same pressures and constraints. And that's what the studio is today. And it integrates with the business. It doesn't mesh up with the factory. It's able to kind of be separate and free. It's really important, I think, for that to work. It can create something that might go to the factory, but that's not its goal. It's really to work with the material, explore the craft, push that. And then we sell those objects too. And they're, you know, they're more, they take a lot more time. There's a lot less volume and all that. But anyway, that was that was what I wanted to do, to kind of preserve that, but also have Heath be, you know, what we wanted it to be, was something that was able to do new and old designs at, you know, as a medium kind of scale company.
Mm-hmm. And Patrick, that's interesting because you do old and new designs in old and new ways too, right? I mean, I think you're over four generations, it's certainly evolved.
I sort of thought that the question sort of hovered around how do we inspire future craftspeople? I wanted to kind of share a little bit towards that a little bit versus what how we operate necessarily. But
perfect.
I personally feel like we have an obligation to share and to educate what we know to anyone who'll really listen. you know, whether it's, you know, your sense of scale or how you put things together and what things are important to you, to, you know, Jomo, you said you are, or maybe I read this, but your inspiration for being a furniture designer and, you know, creator was because you had exposure to a wood shop when you were a child.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm sorry to jump in. I feel like now looking back, back then it was something to do because we were really high school kids and it was something to do outside the house. So we would go to this local wood shop. You know, we were not allowed to touch machines, but we did all the handwork that you would expect. And it played a role reflecting back now.
I absolutely was probably one out of all of my siblings. There's five of us all together. And I was the one who came home after school and went into the, Kathy, when I was a kid, it was called the plant. I think studio somehow is a little bit too small from what we do. And so I am just torn at all the time how to call it. But I was the one who kind of came back and, you know, played, if you will, in, you know, color or printing or, you know, wallpapering the bathroom of the factory or whatever it was. So, you know, I was inspired and I think that those things we create are so important in our younger generations.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's interesting. It's funny that I was thinking about some of the, it's like the French mills that have been doing this for generations too. It's like, they're very plain about the whole thing. They're just like, we're a factory, you know? They make the most beautifully hand-woven silk things that they've done since the 18th century. They're like, we're a factory, you know?
I signed the Shibori workshop, very intense in the middle of the Japanese countryside, very accomplished individuals in the art form of that. And I was doing it at the end of April, of course, I did it. But to be able to immerse yourself into whether it's, you know, pushing clay in a pinch pot for a couple of hours as a kid, or going to the mountains of Japan and learning Shibori in such a like special way is, you know, it feeds the inspiration, right? So if we teach these kids around the world and in all cultures, imagine the design elements that come out of, you know, all parts of the world, truly.
Mm-hmm. And Brad, you're from an area of the country that has a pretty rich craft tradition too. Did that influence your development as a designer or the work you're doing now, which is broader even?
Yeah, definitely. I grew up in Arkansas in a little tiny town, and I always say my first exposure to design was really going to arts and craft fairs. And you know, for me, that was where I first gained an interest in craft. But also my father had a wood shop behind our house that he would go to in the evenings. It was a hobby. But, you know, I was always fascinated going up there and, you know, everything from the smell of the sawdust to the machinery and, you know, seeing how he could you know, take a block of wood and turn it into a bowl, or, you know, he kept going till he eventually was like able to make furniture. But, you know, as a kid, that was fascinating to be able to see that. And I was always a creative kid anyway. So I think it definitely, I was influenced from an early age. Then when I went to move to New York, I worked with a designer named Jed Johnson, who, and he and his partner, Alan Watsonberg, were huge fans of arts and crafts and Nakashima. And I think that's when I started to be able to see that, you know, really what elevated craftsmanship looked like, and feel so fortunate to have been able to see some of that. And I think it just, you know, reconfirmed my interest in it. And I always have just been a, you know, pretty passionate about craft and try to use a lot of it in my own work as well. Mm-hmm.
It's interesting because I think Jed and Jay too are really, they're also real collectors too. And there's this interesting tension in craft, which is not something that was my questions, but it just occurs to me that between kind of anonymity and signed pieces, because I know they collect things by this the Mouse Man and a lot of other things. And I wonder how that kind of plays into your thinking about craft artisans and design, sort of anonymous pieces versus, you know, pieces with it's really attribution.
Yeah, to me, it's not necessarily about the name so much as it is the artistry and what the person's doing and the skill that they have behind it. And, you know, we talked earlier about the criteria, and those are all things, again, just to reiterate, that we look for when we talk to people is, you know, the quality, the way that they're, you know, using the craft itself, the artistry around it. And, you know, we like to look for unique things that are interesting, but also timeless, and that can also work in a lot of different contexts, modern, casual, formal, traditional. So it's, I don't know, it's interesting, because there's a lot of people out there doing stuff, but I feel like there's a small group of people that are doing, you know, above and beyond what you might find at, dare I say, a small arts and crafts fair in Arkansas. I mean, again, I appreciate what everyone's doing, but there's a certain level of artistry that people are doing that I just think was getting lost. Especially you go to certain, you know, like the AD Home Show or ICFF, and, you know, there were like 5 or 10% of people that were doing just incredible things that I felt like weren't necessarily getting the attention that they deserved, which is one of the reasons that we opened the showroom.
Interesting. It's an interesting kind of whole, there's sort of this whole range of influence, a whole range of stories embedded in the objects that I think is interesting too. And I think, I mean, but listen, storytelling is a little bit of a buzzword now too, right now, but I wonder if, but objects do speak to some extent. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that, Jomo, sort of the kinds of stories that, and narratives that come through your, through your work, really.
Look, every object that I come up with is based on some research I've done on my own African heritage. There might be slight tendency to do a little bit more from my Ethiopian side because that's where I grew up. But, you know, when I'm looking at, this is, I think, explaining a little bit about my creative process might help a little bit. So I have a tendency to go through a whole bunch of books, especially old books on African design patterns. So I'm not specifically looking on, you know, I love designing chairs because I find, like most industrial designers, chair has to be the most challenging piece of furniture. But outside of that, what I do is I go look for inspirations from anything African. And one of the reasons I do that is because I feel like the world is full of the other things that you see. Like you mentioned, when you introduced me, I've had the opportunity to go to pretty large shows, pretty well-known furniture shows. And I see the same thing again and again. And I don't want to be part of the same thing again and again. So I'm hearing an echo.
Yeah, I'm hearing an echo too.
But so, I mean, for example, take my Ashanti stool. The Ashanti stool is an inspiration that I found from Ghana. A seat is considered in most African and sub-Saharan Africa cultures, it's the seat of the soul. It is the stool in some traditions, as when you die, is even buried with you. So seating has this spiritual connection with certain cultures. So the appreciation and the passion that goes into it, I want it to be reflected at that. When you look at my piece, do I want you to say, wow, yes, that's the goal, one of the goals. I mean, I don't want to do another chair that looks like it came from Steelcase. I incorporate. So what makes me slightly different is from what you see traditional African craftspeople are doing is because I went to school and I went through the whole ergonomics part of the study, that is incorporated into it. But other than that, I am carrying on the tradition of, you know, like we are talking about a few minutes earlier, of the no-name builder who made that beautiful piece of stool, but you don't know who did it. The only difference is, you know, I did it, I'm from Africa, and I carry all that tradition that has been passed on through all of these objects that I've, you know, pretty much socked in living, growing up in the continent, being reinterpreted as part of my story, my travel, my heritage. And, you know, you can pick and analyze each one from where it came. I mean, for example, my Borati stool is a reinterpretation of a headrest used by the Oromo people in Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. So if you see it, it's a tiny headrest that tribesmen carry that they put on their neck, and you might have seen it in different places, including the Met Museum. And, you know, I take that and I say, what does the silhouette of the shape say to me? Mm-hmm. You know, so it goes through iterations of sketches and drawings, and, you know, something pops up through the process. But it is based on that piece that, you know, tribesmen carry with them, and they need to rest, but they don't want to mess up their nice, you know, hairdo. They put it on their neck and, you know, lie down for a little bit, then pick it up, put it in, you know, right next to them and travel. So I love that type of connection that has nothing to do with furniture, getting into my furniture piece, and it becomes part of the story.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. And I think it's interesting too, because you talked about showing places, and which takes me also to this question of fairs and how the work is getting out there and how everything's really connected in terms of the makers and companies like yours supporting local economies, supporting global economies, really. I wonder if Kathy, you might speak to that a little bit.
So how things, like in this moment?
Oh yeah, I guess how things in this moment, and also just sort of how, you know, the kind of, the impact of working in this way on communities.
Oh yeah.
In general. And then I think perhaps how that is either becoming amplified or changing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for us, like when we decided to try to take on Heath and make it work today, I mean, one of the things that excited us was that we saw that, can you hear me?
Someone actually called to play Roblox with my son on, and it went to the computer. I apologize. That's about technology, not artistry.
Love it. Okay, so back to just, I think we were, oh, gosh, what was I?
The impact of sort of the work that you do on communities, whether local and then.
I mean, the thing that we saw happening is both my husband and I came from a background where the manufacturing and the design were totally separate. And so the impact of the manufacturing was in a culture and a continent that was not in community, right? So that felt, I don't know, I started doing that right out of school. I work for Nike. So this is like a radically different experience, right? And working with those kind of factories. And when we thought about having manufacturing in our own community, especially in a way that was connected to something that had history and tradition in our community, and then added on this layer of the kind of jobs it could provide, it just felt like it was so important. And that if it didn't continue, I mean, you just see what the lack of this kind of work and these kind of facilities, once they go away, what it does to the community, right? And Heath was like smaller and artisan kind of factory always, but we just thought it was so important to, in the Bay Area, to be able to kind of have this, and couldn't believe actually that it had survived, you know, the 80s and the 90s. So that was important to us, to keep that whole, I mean, everything that it does for your community. It's not just the jobs that you create. There's other, you know, resources that you're using locally, you know, and it's makes the place more diverse, more vibrant. And it's important, but it's a battle, you know, where we are still, even so much harder than when we started, which is amazing because we didn't think that would happen. And then, I don't know, I guess the other thing to throw in is just for us, the localness of it was important because it was like vanishing, you know, everything, every place you go, everything feels kind of the same. So like, why can't we just kind of focus our business on, you know, our community? Why do we have to roll it out in every major city kind of thing? So we didn't take that approach, you know, for the jobs and to try to build that community. And now, you know, in this moment, it's extra hard because we have a very tangible business where most of the business comes from selling direct to our own, you know, through our own retail stores. So what happens when that's no longer, you know, viable, and how's that gonna shift? So that's the question, and other ways of connecting with your customers is important right now. I guess that also, yeah, we do like to support other craft in our community, and in our own way, and try to create forums for that. That also now, like, you know, Brad's events are at this moment are pretty hard to figure out exactly how they should be. Mm-hmm.
He's going to tell us a little bit about that, I think. How are you adapting? I was going to ask Patrick to sort of chime in on the question of manufacturing in a sort of small community. So we can go either way. We can, but I do want to come back to that.
For sure. I mean, I think what it does is it creates such a broad scope of interest. I was overhearing one of our employees who's new but had worked for another hand-printed textile studio, amazingly enough, just down the street. And I overheard him referring to his job as making art. And I was kind of like, wow, that's really cool that this opportunity is here. Mm-hmm. He is a craftsperson by all means. He does something that might look pretty easy, but actually has an incredible amount of skill and patience and in hand. I think it's lovely to be able to have that here and support it. And we're a small team. I'm not nearly as large as I'm sure Kathy's team and crew are, but as such, I also feel like it helps us maintain our DNA, which is we want to inspire the interior designer. We want to inspire the furniture maker. Sure, happy when you buy fabrics that we've created as part of collections or stories or this sort of thing, but we really do hope that our facility is something that really helps you express individuality and flair or seriousness or whatever it is. So you know, how we're reaching out to our marketplace is a lot of direct, partly because Level of education in various larger design centers we're not the easiest company to understand. It takes a little bit to wrap your head around all the options and all of the things that can happen. And so we do need someone who has that special time to show till it.
Mm-hmm. So I think that's...
Sorry.
I'm sorry to interrupt. I was going to say, it's interesting because one of the questions was really, how do you empower artisans? And I think there are very practical ways to do that. But I also think that the way you talk about the work that they do, the way you talk about and value the work of the people in your company is probably extremely empowering too, because there are certainly practical things, but there's also an attitude of respect and
pride, really.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I didn't. I lost that for a second.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But you know, we're exploring doing pop-up experiences in markets. Mm-hmm. We just feel like we can tell this story better than someone else can. We're not there. We don't have a showroom. We don't have a store. But there's vibrant design happening everywhere, and we could go to Nashville and, you know, find a cool spot and do a great display and navigate social distance barriers in a myriad of ways. And, you know, it costs less than putting all the fabric in a showroom at the end of the day. And you really connect and you explain your product and all your capability.
Mm-hmm. I think it's really a time. It is a time, and it has been even before now, when people are really evaluating their systems, their business, and how to reach their customers. So I think Brad can probably speak to that too, because you do that. You've created massive events to reach customers, and you do. And right now, you are rethinking how to do that and how to support the makers that you work with.
Yeah, we've been working on a couple of things. One, in the new year, we started to develop an e-commerce component to the Field and Supply website. And so that's been something we had been working on. And then when COVID hit and there was a question of whether or not we'd be able to do our spring event, we quickly looked into how we could potentially have a virtual market. And, you know, it was important that it not just be a website that you go to and be able to buy a product, because part of what I think people really enjoy about Field and Supply is the experience itself. And so we've been working with tools so that, let me jump ahead. We actually are doing the virtual market the same weekend at the end of July that when we were going to have our spring market. And we have been working with tools so that the artisans themselves can have a video feed so that people can interact with them throughout the 4 days. We're expanding it to 4 days, and you know, vendors will have a lower, you know, will have incentive for people to buy, whether it's a discounted price or limited edition pieces. You know, we're still gonna have like a food component with, you know, recipes, and there'll be a soundtrack that you can listen to. Like, we just want it to be very rich and experiential, sort of like the fair itself. The other thing that we did as soon as COVID hit was I wanted to make sure attention wasn't getting lost with the makers. And so we created an initiative called the Maker Moment on Instagram, and we did a website called amakermoment.com. And each day we ask all of our vendors from the showroom and from Field and Supply, we sent them all questionnaires, and each person sent in their questions and answers to really get to know the maker and put a face to the name. And it's been a lot of fun, even for me, when I have these deep relationships with so many of these people, I was learning things about them that I didn't know about. And it's just been a way to kind of keep their name out there, something to look forward to. We did kind of hit the pause button the last week and a half, just because, you know, I was just wanted to be super sensitive to what was happening in the country. And I knew I needed time to sort of reflect on where we were as a country and educate myself on some things. And so, you know, we're looking forward to bringing that back, but I also just want to, you know, be very sensitive to what's happening right now. I think there's a lot for all of us to reflect on and think about. And so we've just kind of hit the pause button on that for the moment.
Mm-hmm. I think that's very true. I mean, I think it's an interesting moment to figure out how to, you know, how to move forward. I think one of the things about craft for me and design is that it is so important to hear individual voices. It is so important to hear voices collectively and really examine how we look at things, how we look at our own taste, how we look at what we like, what we don't. And I think that's something in the design community that has come up this week. And I feel like people who are thoughtful about craft and making things can kind of lead, you know, really be a part of that discussion, or try to. I was going to ask you, Brad, also, I mean, all this digital, you know, one of the things that's interesting about your event is that it's so wonderful to be together in person, but there is this kind of deep support that you get through the digital space. Is that something that you see continuing to work in tandem?
I think so. I mean, that, you know, one of the things for us that we got so much feedback on every year was, you know, where can we find these things? Where can we buy these things year round and not just that particular weekend? And so that's one of the reasons we wanted to have the e-commerce component, was so that there was, you know, this dialogue throughout the year, not just two weekends. Mm-hmm. And we'd like to, you know, we will continue the Maker Moment series because there are so many people out there with beautiful work and interesting stories. And I think that it's, you know, there's so much to learn from everyone, not just about their artistry, but about their background and what their interests are, because I feel like attracts like. And so I have a feeling that, you know, someone that we sort of have built a relationship with is going to have a fascinating podcast that they want to share, or an incredible musician that they like to listen to. And so I think there are all these tendrils that go along with, you know, artisans. And so I think it also layers the narrative, you know, and a lot of that can be messaged through digital.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting that, side note, my next door neighbor up here runs the Fisher Center at Bard, and he was like, it's actually kind of amazing because they had this talk with N.K. Jemisin, the writer, and someone else whose name I can't remember. And he was like, you know, it's kind of great because at the Fisher Center, we could have gotten 800 people in, and they had like tens of thousands of people listening to this. Yeah. So I think that real life experiences and the intimacy of that is so important, but amplifying voices is also incredibly important. And I think the things have to go hand in hand, and we have to use all the tools at our disposal. You know, it's not, you know, it's not the 18th century. It's, you know, even if you're turning something on a wheel, you know.
I think that's one of the things we've learned through this, you know, shutdown is like, that we can still all be together. It's not the same, obviously, but, you know, there is still a way to connect, which is, I think, will kind of change the landscape also of how people run their businesses.
Yeah, I would like to chime in on that. I mean, as the, being part of the Black Artists and Designers Guild, we do have our weekly Tuesday call-in, check-in call-in thing. Initially, we just started it to make sure we just dialogue, you know, what's happening on our side, you know, just to check if everybody's okay, do some workshops. But I really doubt we will stop this weekly call once everything goes back to normal. I think we have discovered each other even more intimately through these weekly calls, and I personally enjoy it. We do product presentation, each designer or artist and guild member give a presentation of their journey and their what they're offering, so each of us understand much better. So what was happening prior to that is whenever we're involved in an event and a few of us travel for that, that is when we have our dialogue. That's when over dinner, over breakfast, you know, over lunch. But then we're busy with shows, yeah? You're talking about your piece here. Melanie could be talking about her work over there. And there is not, you know, by the end of the day, you're tired. So, but on the flip side, we would have never thought this thing would be so productive. It would be continuing instead of, oh, now things are back to normal, let's stop this. I really doubt, at least for us, that will happen. Mm-hmm.
And that kind of also, it's interesting because the work the Black Artists and Designers Guild is doing is so important and moving forward too. And it kind of brings me to my last question, which is about engaging, training, and promoting the next generation. Because I know the BAD Guild is developing educational programs and a fund for supporting current members, students, future designers, future creators as well. So I guess that's the question. How can we ensure that this kind of craft tradition is inspiring and to the next generation and continues?
So for us, I mean, one of the reasons we established the guild is because of, you know, we most of us have run into representation issues. I've done, for example, what I've been doing for 25 years. The traction I got is within the last 2 years. So the 23 years, you know, you take the last week and a half, I've doubled what my Instagram traffic in 1 week because of, you know, multiple unfortunate incidents. And it shouldn't have been like that. Should have been, like I said, I've been involved in international shows. I've shown my work, it's made it to a few books. But having access to even have a dialogue about my work has been difficult. You know, part of it is not being able to tell my own story or how I define what African furniture is. What I run into is, okay, this is what tourists buy, and this is the definition of what African furniture is. And you are outside of that scope. But anyway, that is my little struggle. But when we collaborated and we organized, one of the goals was, you know, how do we create a legacy? Legacy is front and center of what we're doing. If I can't pass on what I've learned to my, you know, I'll try to my own kids, but to others. And it's amazing the amount of emails and IMs I'm getting. I'm actually having a really hard time keeping up with most of this. And half of them are other Black designers and students just asking basic stuff. How did you make it? You know, how did you have the patience to last this long? Just simple things. How do I overcome the struggle? Including, you know, my parents don't want me to study design. They don't think it has future in it. How do we communicate again with, as Black artists and designers? How do we communicate as one of, you know, this is a place that you can make a living and you can create new things, bring in new things into the industry that no one else has seen. So yes, passing the torch and building a system where we can get into schools, even at an early age, is something we're really working on. Mm-hmm.
And I think that work experience apprenticeship, I don't know if either of you, Patrick or Kathy, have any kind of apprenticeship programs or ways that you're kind of teaching on the job.
Mm-hmm. We have such a wide range of jobs, and we generally, for most of the jobs that are in the plant, we train, and the skill range varies, right? So those jobs aren't, then there's the other things that happen, which I think is more where you want the focus to go to kind of keep the legacy of craft. And those are things where there has been positive change that we've seen in the 18 years we've been doing this. We could not find anybody who had studied ceramics coming to knock on our door in 2003. Now there's a lot. So it's it's kind of happened, but there's still this like lack of connection on like, well, what other than us, like what are the other jobs and how can we help people who have the interest in working with their hands again, understand how they can make their way with that. Because there's not a lot of Heaths out there, but I think there's a lot of opportunity for people starting new things, doing things. And the thing that the craft enables you to do is keep things at this kind of small scale. And if you can make that viable, you just kind of create a more balanced world, because if everything is just at mega scale, it's just not a beautiful place anymore.
Okay. No, I definitely believe that creating opportunity for people to come and spend a few days with us or even a season with us. You know, there are limitations where we don't have a subway system or housing right down the street. So what I found is that those that actually do show up so want to be here. Mm-hmm. And I think that we kind of then get like the best, right? It's not just like, yeah, I'm moving to Boston and I'm gonna get a job doing graphic design, mm-hmm. right? It's really, I want to work for a ceramics company and so I'm going to make that happen. I do find that, you know, obviously, you know, to me, teaching someone any portion of a craft also shows them patience, because you cannot create a high gloss finish on wood with, you know, in 35 minutes of buffing, right? It takes layers and process to it. And that is patience, which is why you're 25 years in, you're like, 25 years? And this is 3 years ago? This is all you're giving me?
Patience.
And I feel that with Tillet, you know, I see its beauty, I see its capacity. It could certainly be, you know, a multiple million dollar brand. And then I say, but is that necessary, mm-hmm. right? And so certainly starting your business out of a garage because you have a passion and you were touched by someone and then you went on and learned a skill to aid that, awesome. It's my kind of person.
Mm-hmm. Well, I love what Kathy said also about a balanced world. And I think that's the thing. It's like you guys, you all create joy, you create jobs and, you know, set a legacy. And I think that it is time for change. And I think that a more balanced world is kind of the goal and the way forward, no?
I also wanted to add, Sabine, I think what's important is for people like myself as an interior designer or have a showroom is to continue to educate the end consumer, the end user, on the value of craftsmanship, why mm-hmm. things may be the price that they are, the legacy that they will continue to have with a beautiful piece of furniture. And so I think that's also equally important because, you know, it's got to be good for everybody. It's, you know, the craftsperson needs to be compensated. And I just think that it's important that people understand the value of craftsmanship.
Absolutely. I agree. So I think we're at 5. Sorry, I went a little long, but I don't think I have any. We were supposed to leave time for a Q&A and I kept looking, but there are no questions, but everybody's still there. So I think you've answered all their questions.
Sometime soon. You guys are amazing. I respect all of your-
One question. Oh, sorry to interrupt. I was like, I'm not used to pop-ups. One question. Oh, someone says, as a newly launched furniture maker, what some of the best routes were for getting your designs out there and seen? Thank you for the discussion. It's especially timeless for myself, Chad Rendell. Oh, that's very nice.
I did respond offline, but I can repeat it. So, and partially I mentioned it for me before joining the guild. And when I rebooted my career, what I found out is going to design festivals that are smaller because trade shows are very expensive, where it was the best way. You also get to meet and see and network with people who are you know, within that space. They're struggling like you. They're trying to find their space, their spot. Most are young. So it's a good place to start. Now, on the flip side, what I've noticed was, especially I noticed this in Milan, and I started researching, how about if I want to put up my own show? It's gotten very expensive to be part of the design festival. So everybody knows, you know, the residents of Milan know that they can rent the floor space of the first floor, and sometimes the second floor to up and coming designers. And there is, you know, space is tight. So it does get expensive, and it's the largest design festival I've ever seen. So there is on that flip side, but you can always go to a smaller festival. You can do the one in New York, probably, you know, Toronto, and, you know, close by. If you're based in the US, if you're out of Europe, there are multiple of them. But I would say do that, do your own pop-up, like discussed earlier. There are other ways and venues, once you design your work, to promote it. You know, you've got to reach out to your network and be part of a collective if you have to be. Like us, being a collective as Black designers has helped me and others immensely. And probably one of the reasons you're talking to me and not as part of the listening and into this conversation. So that was my advice. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. And thank you. I think, Patrick, I think I'm going to let you close it out, because I think you had a good, I know you had a good close that I interrupted.
No, I don't know. I mean, just share, teach, embrace, spread it, for sure. And thank you all for being amazing, and stay safe.
Thank you all for being.
Thank you. Thanks for making me part of it.
Yeah.
Thank you very